volunteerism. Some of the highlights, I believe, include having to make a decision at about 5 years old who I wanted to live with. Some of the laws of Jim Crow that existed during the period of time that I was growing up, such as a whites only counter and those kinds of things. Also, some of the opportunities and successes that I had during my career in the information technology age. And I talk about that again in more detail in just a second. There's also emphasis on the segregated school environment that I experienced. And I go into some depth about that. And I talk about, lastly, making a difference in the lives of other people through advocacy and volunteerism. I graduated from high school, and I want to take a minute and just talk just a little bit about North Carolina A&T, because it sets the setting for me leaving and going into the military. I attended North Carolina A&T, and I lived in Scott Hall. Scott Hall at the time was the largest dormitory of its type on the East Coast. It housed 1,100 men, and it was a real experience. My hometown, for example, was only 1,500 people. So Scott Hall was almost as big as my hometown. There was a lot of activism on campus. And one of the things that I emphasize in that part of my life is the Greensboro Uprising that took place during my freshman year. We experienced 3 nights of live gunfighting between students and the Greensboro police and the National Guard. Willie Grimes was killed on the second night of the gunfire. And it ended with an invasion of the, by the National Guard of campus. The gunfire ended every morning about the same time, just about daybreak, just enough time for, I guess, the general public not to be able to tell what was really going on. And this particular morning, I crawled from under my bed, which is where I had to live or sleep during the night, because it was not safe to sleep in the bed. And I grabbed my toiletry bag. I went to the bathroom, and then I heard an announcement over the intercom from a student saying that National Guards are going to take Scott Hall. So I immediately grabbed my toiletry bag. I wrapped up my half robe around my body, but before I could get into the hallway, I could hear gunshot. And as I stepped into the hallway, I could smell the strong choking odor of tear gas. And I saw National Guardsmen coming towards me with guns. They were shooting doorknobs off of doors, knocking down doors, using their rifles to break everything that was breakable. And this incident, they didn't usher me downstairs along with some others. And we stood between two formations of guardsmen for about 4 hours. Then they released us and allowed us to go back into the dorm to get our things to leave. But this caused me to evaluate, this had a major impact on me in my life. And it caused me to evaluate really who I was. I talk about that in detail. I go into detail about all three nights. And I talk about my feeling. And one of the emotions that I had was anger. I had an anger leaving that, going through and leaving that experience. 3 years later, of course, I graduated and I joined the Navy. And that was a totally, completely different type of environment that I had been accustomed to. One of the very first things that I realized after joining the Navy or being in boot camp was that of about 100 people who were in the group that I was in, almost all of us had not had any interaction with members of the opposite race. There were probably 7 African Americans from in the group, and they came from states from Georgia through New York, I believe. But all of the other people were from the Midwest. Some people even talked about the fact that they had never seen an African American in their town. And they only had knowledge of African Americans except seeing them on television. And I point out later just how little, how seldom they saw African Americans on television, because you simply did not, it was a rare thing to see African Americans on television at that time. So because of that situation, it set us up for obvious race conflicts. But the one and only race conflict that we had, I explained it, or I talk about it in the book, because I learned a lot, and everybody else that was involved with that got a very valuable lesson that day. We had been in boot camp for several weeks, and we had not had a lot of opportunity to interface with each other. But then we reached a point where we could socialize on the weekend, and none of us had seen television. So this particular morning, seven of us African-Americans had decided we were going to watch Soul Train. None of us had watched any TV. But when we got into the TV room, the white recruits, 90 some of them, were sitting there waiting to watch a hockey game. So one of the African-Americans asked for the remote control, but he instantly got a response, no, because we're getting ready to watch a hockey game. And then several of the white recruits stood in front of the TV. Well, we stood in, we got up and we stood in front of them. Now, we were grossly outnumbered, but we didn't care, because we thought it was our right to be able to watch the program that we wanted to watch, and they felt the same way. But what happened was another white recruit came in, a level-headed thinking person, and he saw what was happening. And he said, hey, I want to watch hockey too, but it's coming on again in about an hour. And I remember all of us just standing there and looking around at each other. We all had really dumb expressions on our faces as we stood there, because as simple and as foolish as it was, we were about to fight over the television. And there was the Navy could not have justified keeping us in the Navy, because we couldn't get accustomed to each other in boot camp. There was no way possible that we could have worked together on a ship or in a submarine. So we all would have been put out of the Navy. But just one level-headed thinking recruit came in and prevented that from happening. Now, I would learn later that an aircraft carrier did have to be stopped because of a race riot. But the point that I'm making here is there's always an opportunity to intercede or to look at what's really going on and defuse the situation, which is something that we need really, really badly today. That was a really important lesson, and I talk about that in the book. And I also share both humorous and some serious experiences that I had. Some of them were very humorous and others humorous. I was stationed in Charleston. So on the weekend, I would go home. I would jump on the train, Amtrak train, and I would go home. Well, the Amtrak train is always late. So every Monday morning, I was late. So I had been warned that if I was late one more time, I would get put out of the class. Well, I drove up, so I assured my superiors that I would not be late again. And I thanked them for not putting me out of class. That Sunday night, as I I was driven up to the Amtrak station. The train was leaving. So obviously I missed it. So I jumped into a taxi and I asked the taxi driver if he could catch up with the train the next stop. That was about 20 miles away. And he said, no, I can't do it, but I can take you to the freeway and maybe you can try hitchhiking. Well, my thought was, what do I have to lose? The next train does not come until tomorrow morning. So he took me out, he put me out on the freeway, and I got out and it was pitch dark. I couldn't even see my hands. No cars were coming by on either side of this freeway. But eventually a car came by, it slowly stopped after it passed me. And then it backed up and the individual rolled the window down. He said, where are you going, sailor? And I said, Charleston. So he said, get in, I'm not going to Charleston, but if you drive yourself there, you can do that and wake me up when you get there. Well, when I got inside the car and I started to drive, I learned that this was a sailor, a white sailor who was on his way to his next duty station. He was stationed on a submarine in Miami, and he didn't have to be there for another week. So he had a plenty of time. But this was a point I make, this was a Jim Crow period. He took a big chance to do that. Even though I did have on my Navy uniform. That was an experience I thought was worth telling in the book, because just hitchhiking alone to Charleston was a lot. But then I decided that for a week I wouldn't go home, but the following week I did go home. And when I went home, I said, I'm gonna make sure I'm back at the Amtrak station on time so that I can get back to class on time. And I did that. The only problem was when I pulled into, we pulled into Charleston that Monday morning, I was seeing the signs that said Charleston. And I dozed off. And about 10 minutes later, the train was moving again. And I jumped up and I asked the porter, what's going on? He said, well, we're just leaving Charleston. I said, what? I got to get off here. So he said, no, this train won't stop again until we get to Georgia. So he said, the only way you're going to get off of this train is that you can jump off. So I thought about it and I made a split decision to jump. So I grabbed my Navy bag and I jumped off of the train. And I'm telling you, I don't know if anybody's ever jumped off a moving train, but that's not fun. When I jumped off of the train, another train was coming in the opposite direction. And to make a long story short, I was scratched up. I was bleeding. My shoes were busted. My clothes were practically torn off. But when I got up, I really couldn't believe it. I had survived. And so I got up and a person who was standing on his houseboat was shocked. And he came over, he took me to base. But the thing is, I did not get put out of class, because I go into how serious of a situation this was for me and how important this was. I go into more detail about that in the book. But I graduated from this class and I received orders to Morocco. I received orders to Morocco. This was my first choice. And it was my first choice for some reasons that I also talk about in the book. And I remember on base being briefed on how to handle myself when I was approached by spies. So I started, because there were two or three of us that were briefed, because we were all going to different places across the world in similar environments. And I was told how to handle myself under those circumstances, and that by the time I got there, our adversaries, Russia and some others, would have a file on me. So my first question was, why in the world would they want a foul on me? Who would want a foul on me other than my family? But when I got there, I learned that it was a secret base. It was a secret base. Congress didn't even know that it was there. And one of the very first things after I reported was I had to meet with the ambassador. And I remember sitting with the ambassador for with him and his wife having tea and cookies and for about 2 hours. And then we took a tour of the embassy. But then when we came back, the ambassador made it very clear as to why we had, he had called us there. He didn't just call me there to welcome me. He then told us that if you get into any trouble at all, then there's absolutely nothing that the United States can do for you, that you are on your own. And I listened closely to what he said, but I was thinking, who in the world would not pay attention and not stay out of trouble? But at the time, I had no idea how easy it was to violate one of those, things that he had warnings that he had given us. And one of them was going to Algeria, because Morocco borders Algeria. And that was a no-no because lots of people had been taken, some people rather, had been taken hostage by some terrorists. But when one of the other things about the tour there and the place that I worked was that the Russian, first of all, we had to be invisible. We couldn't wear military clothing other than inside that building, period. So we got a civilian clothing allowance. We couldn't use, we couldn't have anything that identified us as being American. And there was very few of us there. So usually if people saw us, they thought that we were tourists. The Russians were about a mile across the desert. They did not have to be invisible. And they were there for one reason. And that reason was to prevent us from doing our job, from prevent us from communicating to the fleet. Because we provided communications to ships and submarines in the Atlantic Ocean and that part of the world. And we also relayed Radio Free Europe throughout that part of the world. And I described in the book a kamikaze-like work environment that I was in. I won't go into any detail because I include that in the book, but I will only say it involved dynamite. And leaving Morocco, I went to the Philippines. I was stationed at a message center there. There's a lot involved with that, so I won't go into any detail in this description, but I do talk about it a lot in the book. But one thing that was really important is that I lived under martial law. We had to be off the street there by 9 o'clock, and they were serious. If you were caught on the street after 9 o'clock, there were no questions asked. You went to jail. And you had to, I think curfew was over for about somewhere around 5 in the morning, somewhere around that period. And I lived and worked in the jungle. I talk about that in the book as well. It was a real experience. I talk about jogging through the jungle, for example, with monkeys standing on or sitting on the fence. I wouldn't do that today, but at that stage of my life, you know, I felt if I got attacked, no big deal. I'll just do what I can to try to survive. I also talk about international Jim Crow while overseas. I talk about, because part of this book is about Jim Crow, and I noticed international Jim Crow that had basically been exported by way of movies into the Philippines. And I teamed up with some other African-Americans and we devised some activities to counteract debt. And we did things like we held some fundraisers for orphanages and those kinds of things. I wrote articles about Black history. We did a lot of things to address the issue. And while we were there, we did impact the image of African Americans overseas or in that part of the world. I also started to work on my master's degree while I was there, because we had a campus of a University of Southern California there. And I was able to finish up when I got to San Francisco. So I left the Philippines and I was relocated to Stockton, California. And I was exposed to cutting edge technology of the day. But one of the highlights that I talk about in the book is fighting the Navy from within, because I was falsely accused of 5 different accounts that either one of them could have resulted in me getting a bad conduct discharge. And I go into detail about that in the book. I talk about attending a court-martial arraignment for several falses. And I want to reemphasize, being convicted on any one of those accounts, I would have been put out of the Navy, sent to jail with a bad conduct discharge. But I was able to survive that, and I talk about that. Even up until the last half hour that I was in the Navy, the Navy tried to give me a bad conduct discharge. And again, for nothing that I had done, I only requested that some other African Americans get some training. And that was it. I became dirt. But I learned a very valuable lesson from that experience that I share in the book. I won't go into it, but I talk about that in detail in the book. I entered a civilian life, and I had to have a very non-traditional means of searching for a job, because there were hardly any jobs at that time. I have allergies today. There were no jobs at that time. We were in the middle of a recession. So I focused on a particular job. I didn't have a contact for this job. So I would call the network manager on a routine basis. I had weekdays off, and I would drive 80 miles on those days off, and I would call him from a phone booth down the street, and they would always say he's not available. But one day he answered the phone, he didn't answer the phone. Somebody else answered the phone and said, he's standing right here, hold on. So he came on, and I said, I would like to come in sometime and talk to you about what I can do to help you at the data center. So he said, good. Why don't you give me a call sometime, we'll do that. And I said, before he could hang up, I said, no, I'm 10 minutes away. I can be there in 10 minutes. So he said, I can only give you 15 minutes. So I went down to the building, the data center, and I set up in the conference room. And he came in, he said, I can only give you 15 minutes. I had my degrees, I had my resume, my goals and objectives, 2 of the textbooks that I was currently using at Golden Gate University for a telecommunication management program. And after about 5 minutes, he stood up and he said, I'm gonna announce a job in a couple of weeks, and I would like to have you apply for it. So I extended my hand, we shook hands, he left, he went back in. Needless to say, that job resulted in lots of opportunities for me. It kicked off a long string of successes in my career. I helped to implement one of the first, if not the first, national digital wide area network backbone after Judge Harold Green divested AT&T. That was a great opportunity. Not everybody has had the opportunity to do that. I designed a wide area network for a major federal agency. And also designed several telemedicine networks across the country. I served as associate professor of telecommunications for two colleges. And again, all of this stemmed from this non-traditional method of searching for a job that I used and that opportunity that I got there and my Navy technical background that I had. So one part, a major part of the book that I talk about is advocacy. So I want to just take a minute or two and emphasize some advocacy. I created a organization called Parents and Citizens for Quality Education. And I created that organization because of an incident with my son. My son was in high school at this time, and I talk about this in the book, and he had not been behaving well at school. So I looked at he received a note from school that I had to sign. And I requested of him, what is it that you've done that would cause you to be suspended for 2 days? Well, he told me what had happened. I didn't believe that. I didn't think he was telling me the whole truth. So I took him to school the next morning. And when I took him to school, we sat down with the principal and he told me exactly what my son had said. So I said, is this really what happened? So you suspended my son about this? And he said, that's right. He said, I wouldn't put it exactly that way, but that's why he was suspended. And I talk about that in the book. And the bottom line was that I was not going to allow that to happen. So I said, we got up and I'm going to escort my son to his classroom. And I started and the principal said, no problem. I think I can waive this time. The next week I had to go to school again and I had to take my son something. And I was looking for him at school and I couldn't find him. So I saw these African-American kids over on the far side of campus. So I walked there and it was the African-American kids and my son taking our lunch. And I asked, why are you guys here on this side of the campus all alone? And what he said to me angered me. He said, because if we stay here, security, out of the way, security will leave us alone. And I realized that he and the other kids, African-American kids, were being mistreated for no reason other than the fact that they were Black, for Jim Crow reason. But the most important thing is that they were participating. They were participating in it by volunteering to stay out of the way. And I said, no, this is gonna stop. I'm gonna stop it. So I organized an organization called Parents and Citizens for Quality Education. And we had a lot of accomplishments. Tremendous number of accomplishments. And
Lester, I have to interrupt. This organization is absolutely phenomenal. You must get a copy of this book. I'm sorry you can't see it because I've got the screen on, but you must get his book. And we will continue this dialogue because Lester is speaking on Monday, August the 2nd. So with Donna Ford's sponsored event. And so both of them are our sponsors today. And thank you for sponsoring us. And what a life. What a life you've led, Lester, and Donna too, and I'm sure Harold has a whole slew of stories too. What a life. really a weak start, an unapologetic present. The book is available everywhere, and we will bring Lester back on August the 2nd, and we'll talk about that organization and about a blueprint that he has. So he's not just telling you about the situation and all that he's been through, but he's actually done a blueprint of how he thinks you can solve the problem, which I think is very rare, because most people whine and, you know, have these stories, but there's nobody that has a blueprint as good as this one. So thank you, Lester. I will bring you back because Anthony has to leave early, but I will bring you back to close some comments. And I'm going to let Anthony go, and then we'll do questions for both the authors, because Anthony's book is incredible, and I want him to have this opportunity to speak next. But I'll bring you all both back, and we do have time, so sure. Don't worry.
Great.
So yes, but Anthony is another author of several books. I can't keep up with the guy. I can't keep up with you, Anthony. So go ahead and tell us about Simowise. Take your time. Your sound, we can't.